Finally, ladies and gentlemen, I can see we are very exhausted. I'd like to call the Dean of the School of Law, Professor Kiarie Mwaura, to convey the vote of thanks.
Thank you so much. I'm very pleased to be here this evening. One of the questions that I still have in my mind, and it's a question that I grapple with, whenever I go to my school board meetings and the Senate, as well as our Dean's Committee meeting at the University of Nairobi, is a question that always arises. That tells me that we are not approaching this issue with a common approach. When I present my list of students that are admitted to the School of Law and the Dean's Committee, one of the things that I get from the linguists is that, why are you excluding people with Kiswahili? Because we only admit people with a B in English. They tell me that naturally, anyone who is good in Swahili is naturally good in English. My lawyers, my law lecturers in my boardroom are not convinced about that. They are still very resistant and saying that, just like we heard from the speakers who have spoken before, that law is written in a very complex language. Case law is in English, the statutes are in English, the language is complex. How then can you argue that someone who is good in English is naturally good in Swahili, is naturally good in English? I have a very difficult task convincing my board. And now it appears the Council for Legal Education has actually bought that idea from the linguists, because the Council for Legal Education has said you can substitute English in Swahili. If someone does not have an English, B in English, you can take them if they have a B in Swahili. A few law schools, a few universities have actually taken people with B in Swahili in the last 1 year, 2 years. We are soon waiting to see when these lawyers hit the market in 2 years' time, 3 years' time, are they going to be competitive, equally competitive as those lawyers who've got a B in English? So it's something that we're waiting to see, and we would like to see the answers, to get answers to those questions to tomorrow. There's also something which has happened. In our boardrooms, we've been discussing about training of lawyers. We get a lot of people, most of us get concerned about the quality of the lawyers that we're turning out. The practitioners in the field, people working in the corporate world, they are complaining about the languages of the law students that we are producing. And one of the questions that we keep asking ourselves is, what is it that we are not doing right? We are teaching legal research and writing, but it is not working. We are teaching research methodology, it's not working. Do we need to teach law and language for us to be able to bridge that gap? So those are questions that we keep asking ourselves, and we hope that the conference that we are going to be having tomorrow is actually going to be able to provide answers to some of those questions. There's also the issue of culture. When I talk to most people my age and older, they say that the problems we are having today with the young lawyers, we don't see them, or we didn't see them with the older lawyers. Most of the older lawyers who went through the system were very good. And the question we ask ourselves is it the culture that has changed? And in terms of culture, I remember during my days, we had the culture of writing letters. I remember, luckily, all the letters that I got from my girlfriends in high school, I kept them. And once in a while, I actually read them today. And I can tell you the quality of the language was so good. And luckily, I married a wife who was my girlfriend in high school. So she also kept her letters. So I came to see the letters I was writing myself. And when I look at that, what I was writing in high school and what I'm seeing reading at the university, it is very different. So has there been a change of culture? Now the young people are not writing letters anymore. What they're writing is tata on XA, emojis and everything. That culture, could it has it affected? Has it created the problem that we're having? So those are some of the questions, and we hope to get answers to some of those questions so that we can review our programs, so that we can offer relevant programs. So I'm very delighted that we have partnered today at this conference with the USIU Africa, Harvard University African Languages Program, as well as the School of Law in Mwaura, Nairobi, to host this conference. As the Dean of the School of Law in Mwaura, Nairobi, I welcome the discussions that we will be having tomorrow, as they are very timely. This is because the discussions will enable us to tackle important questions relating to African sources of legal knowledge, linguistic human rights, language in education, language learning, language in national integration, language in cultural representation, storytelling and performance, politics of language and cultural meaning. I hope that this is a starting point and that we shall continue to contribute on the question even after the conference ends up tomorrow. I would like to thank USIU Africa, Harvard University African Languages Program, University of Nairobi School of Law, for their invaluable input in organizing this conference. Further, I wish to thank Professor Zeleza for making this conference possible, Professor John Ogane for initiating the conversation, and Dr. Nyarigoti, Professor Kioko, Professor Ngao, Professor Kielgai for their contributions this evening. To the ushers, ICT team, catering, and the entire support team, thank you. I wish to thank all of you for attending and implore upon you to join us tomorrow at the conference. Thank you so much for coming.